Welcome to Artist Space Books and Talks. It's really fantastic to see such a great crowd of people here tonight. Tonight's event is a difficult one to introduce, as I'd hope to be standing here welcoming Haroon Farrokhi and celebrating with him the new book, Haroon Farrokhi Diagrams, edited by Benedict Reichenbach. But it's really incredible to see so many people here, as I said, and I think that serves as evidence of the tremendous impact Farrokhi's incisive thinking, writing, and filmmaking has had on his audience. We are, however, very pleased tonight to be able to pay tribute to Haroon with two people who knew him well and are close to him and his work, Alexander Albero and Thomas Alsasser. In a moment, I will hand over to Alex and Thomas, and after their conversation, we will screen firstly a short clip of Haroon, and then Haroon's seminal film from 1988, Images of the World and the Inscription of War. So as I mentioned earlier, tonight's event also marks the launch of an incredible new book titled Haroon Farrokhi Diagrams, Images from 10 Films, produced by designer Benedict Reichenbach on the occasion of Farrokhi's 70th birthday earlier this year. This publication centers on a visual reading of 10 of Farrokhi's films, and also includes introductions to those films by a number of contributors, including a text by Thomas Alsasser. The book is available for you to browse and to purchase at the bookstore at the front, so please take a time to look at that after tonight's event. So I'm going to give a brief formal introduction to Alex and Thomas. Alexander Albero is an art historian and the Virginia Bladel Wright Professor of Art History at Barnard College, Columbia University, and he's a well-known author of books including Conceptual Art and the Politics of Publicity from 2004. And Thomas Alsasser is a film historian and professor emeritus of the Department of Media and Culture at the University of Amsterdam. He's the author of numerous publications, including recently The Persistence of Hollywood from 2012 and German Cinema, Terror and Trauma, Cultural Memory since 1945. 2013, and as many of you will know, also edited a key collection of essays on Haroon Farrokhi's work titled Working the Sightlines. So without further ado, I'm going to hand over to Thomas and Alex.
Okay, great. Thank you for that introduction. This evening came together. Haroon Farrokhi and I had talked about having a discussion this evening to talk about this new book that he has published, or not published, a new book on his work, Diagrams, I believe it's called, and also to complement the exhibition that that's opening tomorrow at Green Naftali, showing new work. And we had begun to discuss some of the questions that we would take up this evening. And things being what they are, we ultimately decided that we would have I would have a discussion with Thomas, Thomas Alsasser, who is. Probably the person, probably the person in the world that knows the most about Haroon Farrokhi's work, and I thought that this would be the best way to carry out this evening, with the exception perhaps of Ansha Amon and others. Thomas is very familiar and has long been familiar with Haroon Farrokhi's work. So we're going to structure the evening around some of the questions we were going to take up, and we'll take up the questions and keep the discussion at the kind of level that we hope to have had in the first place. But I thought maybe to break the ice in what is obviously an awkward situation, we'd just ask Thomas to briefly, tell us how and when you came to know Haroon Farrokhi's work, or Haroon Farrokhi and his work, and what attracted you, and when this took place.
Yeah, thank you, Alex. It is a little bit odd to be in a situation or be in the chair where Harun should have been sitting. I'm also having to apologize for keeping some crib notes. I literally just flew in day before yesterday. I'm still recovering a little bit, and I have to fly out again tomorrow. So it is a special effort that I'm making, but it's a special effort that I'm very, very pleased to make, because Harun indeed is and was very, very dear to me. And we go back a long way. In fact, I met him in 1976 when I was in Berlin to research a book on New German cinema. And I visited him in Nassauische Straße, Wilmersdorf, on the recommendation of somebody who went to film school with him, Ingrid Oppermann. But at the time, I thought of Harun as a writer and not a filmmaker. I hadn't seen a single of his films, but I had been reading his articles in Film Critique, so I knew him as a writer. And as I was in Berlin to interview filmmakers and critics, he was an obvious person to go to. And at that time, I had just published my first extended article on New German Cinema and Fassbinder, A Cinema Vicious Circle. And so I took that article along as a kind of calling card, and that was definitely the wrong thing to do, because he scoffed and with barely disguised disgust kind of picked up this booklet that I gave him and said, how could anybody seriously talk about Fassbinder? And anyway, the whole thing about New German Cinema is cooked up by PRs in the Goethe Institute, and he wasn't going to have anything to do with it. I thought, well, it was fun. It was really extraordinarily fun talking to him and with him. And I thought, what do I care if he trashes my writing if he's such good company? As we were getting going, he was very generous, and I could actually test that generosity, because I asked him whether by any chance he had a tripod that he could lend me for my Super 8 camera, and he gave it to me, but that was, of course, a good excuse to come back and see him once more. So that was the beginning, and only about a week ago, or 10 days ago, I realized that that was not the first encounter with Harun Faraki, and I now have to go back 20 years earlier to 1956. In 1956, Harun was living in Jakarta, Indonesia. And 1956 is also the year when Harun published his first piece of writing. And he published it in a youth magazine called Rasselbande. And it was an account of his life in Jakarta and an incident with a man who, under dubious circumstances, got himself into the house and actually stole a silver ashtray. And as it happens, this youth journal was called Rasselbande. And in 1956, I was the paper boy distributing Rasselbande in my hometown of Mannheim. So already in 56, I carried Harun's ideas into the world. And I've been doing it ever since. So 60 years.
Okay. Well, that's great. It's a hard act to follow. All right, so I want to begin. I want to begin with a question of montage related to Harun's work. Now, while it's obvious that Harun's work is very concerned with montage and with the kind of distanciation that montage can realize, Harun Faraki didn't think in binarisms. He didn't think in binaries, which function according to the logic of opposition. Instead, he thought in what we could call a logic of difference. If in a binary, the terms of a conflict are always constructed as identical with themselves, or identical to themselves, I should say, as in a kind of either-or opposition to each other, the logic of difference operates according to the conjunction and. Mm-hmm. And we'll see this in Images of the World, where the voiceover will use the conjunction and just before a cut, and then and in another cut, and in another cut, this kind of adding on instead of, you know, montage as an adding on instead of montage as a clash of images, if you will. So what exactly do you think is the relationship between that method of working and the notion of soft montage that Haroon articulated on several occasions, where the cut of montage was synonymous with the conjunction and?
Well, that's very interesting. I mean, obviously, Haroon comes from a fairly classical Marxist background, and so was a dialectical thinker. But I think he also was, at fairly early stage, aware of the pitfalls that binarisms can bring one into. And, you know, we may have it from Derrida and deconstruction, but he didn't have to read the philosophers to have a sense that when you have a binarism, you don't have an either-or or an alternative, because the alternative turns out not to be an alternative, because one of the terms is already subservient to another in a binary relationship. And I think Haroon has many different ways of coming to terms both with keeping the dynamics of dialectical thinking and also making room for, as you say, the paratactic way of organizing sequences. And I think he was also aware, much earlier than some of his colleagues on the left, that notions, effectively binary notions of resistance and opposition, were actually more liable to be co-opted than if you're able to establish a different kind of power relationship, one that one might call a relationship of antagonistic mutuality. For instance, I remember talking to him about hackers, and he was pointing out that a hacker and IBM or Microsoft or Apple live in a kind of symbiotic relationship. They actually benefit from each other, even though there is opposition at the most epiphenomenal level. Underneath, there is a kind of collusion going on. And I think that principle was quite important to him, to see what is the dynamics that plays underneath an apparent opposition in relation to, as I said, cooperation, collusion, and so on. And that comes out in one of his most fundamental principle, the so-called Verbund. In other words, a form of synergy and the way in which different entities find themselves working together. He had this principle very early on in one of his first films, Zwischen den Kriegen, and he derived it from a Marxist thinker called Alfred Sohn Rethel, that very few of us probably have read, but who turned out to be extremely important for Haroon, because Verbund was a way in which, in Alfred Sohn Rethel's terms, the German steel industry had formed a trust. In other words, firms that, on the face of it, were competing with each other for market share actually got together. And this happened in Germany in the early 30s with the steel industry. It happened with the chemical industry in the late 20s. IG Farben is the result of such a trust. And Haroon, and this is one of the interesting things, this is a basic capitalist structure of trust formation. And as we know, the Hollywood film industry was a trust which had to be broken up, or was broken up, in 46, 47. But Haroon used this as his own working principle. So as a freelancer, he had to find commissions all over the place. And what he explained is how, whether he got a commission for a radio play, whether he had an educational spot on television, whether he was working on a new film, or whether he was doing a book review or writing a film review, he was always trying to bring together these different media in some way that allowed the same kind of work input to have these multiple functions within the world of, you know, the public sphere, the media. But coming back to what you were saying about the and about binarism, he also knew that our world today functions through binary, for either or, zero ones. In other words, our digital world is entirely binary, and in a film that I still think is one of his most interesting, as you see, Wie man sieht, he actually takes that particular model, what he calls the fork in the road, as one of the examples. And the fork in the road, or the fork in the river, for him, is the origin of civilization, because that is where cities were first founded. So he uses that fork in the road, either or, and not moving beyond that either or, as actually a kind of founding myth of a particular form of civilization. He also, in this film, uses some of the ideas of another person who's very important, was very important for him intellectually, Wilhelm Flusser, namely where Flusser goes back to Jacquard Loom and so on to have a new genealogy of the digital image, which includes the photograph and the television image. In other words, that whereas we tend to think of these as radically different forms of representation, indexicality and so on, Flusser was thinking that these are all ways in which particles are organized in a particular way. And I think Harun found this very helpful and useful for precisely thinking the difference or the similarity between celluloid and then working with video and then finally working with digital. But there are a couple of other things that are really quite interesting about this. One is that he also had a logic of recto and verso. And I remember another occasion when he was telling me that, you know, he, as a filmmaker, he always takes cuts out of newspapers, you know, always has a newspaper clip. And he said, then I put it away in a drawer or in a filing cabinet, and then 5 years later I pick it up, and what's there is of no interest whatsoever. And then I turn it around, and that's incredibly interesting, but it's missing the last paragraph. So that particular recto and verso logic is one that I think you can also trace in his films. And what you were saying about his voiceover, that's also something that he was often misunderstood. He was often, people say, it's so didactic, it's so dry with his voiceover. In fact, in the States, he was sometimes attacked for using voiceover in what seemed to be a very, well, schoolmasterly way. But as you point out, if you look closely, you see that what he does with his texts is exactly what he does with the images. He edits them. And editing always means leaving something out. It's always to reduce rather than add. And what you really have to be alert to in his commentary are what I would call the non sequiturs. Not just the gaps, but that things are connected and you say, how do they belong together? And there's something missing, or there's, as I said, it's a shift of terrain, and he obliges you to then think, what is the connection? In other words, you do the work, you make the connection, and you know, he leaves you that gap or that play to work this. And if you simply see it as somebody overbearingly commenting, then you've actually you haven't really grasped what Harun's editing is about, even as a filmmaker.
Yeah,
so what you actually get is that he edits, but he never editorializes, and that's a very important distinction.
Well, just a second ago, you touched on another question that I wanted to raise, or another trait of Harun's films, is that they often indexically point to what lies on the margins of the field of vision. For instance, in Images of the World, the Allied reconnaissance camera, as you'll see, many of us know the film, but it's always
worth seeing. We probably have a few spoilers tonight.
So the Allied reconnaissance camera photographs Auschwitz in the Second World War, but it doesn't see what it has photographed. It doesn't see Auschwitz because it's not looking for a camp. It's looking for a factory. In other works, like in Workers Leaving a Factory, workers are depicted as they leave the factory, but the work that they've carried out in the factory isn't represented. I suppose I frame it as a question. I mean, to what extent do you think then that, and we can think of many other cases, where the missing counter shot, the camp or the workers in the factory. To what extent do you think that in many of the cases in his work, it's the missing counter shot that's the actual driving element of the film?
Yes, I like this idea of the missing counter shot, and you can see it in two ways. You can see it just like what I was saying earlier about editing, of leaving gaps. Farocki practices a kind of conceptual Kuleshov effect, that you have to supply not a missing image but a missing concept, or rather the juxtaposition of two shots produce the need to have a mediating concept. So the counter shot could also be a third element. I mean, there's a film of his sometimes called In Comparison or Comparison Through a Third, and the interesting thing is that the third is never mentioned. Comparison Through a Third, if I remember right, it refers primarily to a film about bricklaying, or brick making rather. Mm-hmm. And on the one hand, it is a comparison of different methods of brick making in India, in France, in Ouagadougou or Africa, and in Germany. And in one sense, it's a linear film where you may say from very so-called primitive to very automated. But that's not how the film functions. And I constantly had to say, what is the third that I'm supposed to be comparing it to? Until I realized that what is actually animating it is a metaphor about filmmaking. And the metaphor about filmmaking is, on the one hand, that yes, in a sort of Russian montage way, you make films brick by brick. But at the same time, there was this argument about how in classical filmmaking, as indeed by brickmaking in India and Africa, it was a communal activity and was a collective activity. Whereas as you move to Europe, it gets more and more automated, which seemed to me a way of Farocki reflecting on how filmmaking more and more in the digital becomes post-production rather than production. And so there was no mention at all of film, and nonetheless, you know, because he sets it up by asking you, come back to, is it a binary, is it an and, is it a comparison, is it similarity, what are the relationships between what he shows? And so he really forces you to become very active. What we have in Images of the World is possibly also a matter of framing, of reframing, of unframing images. And you will see in the film that Harun's hand is very important in changing the aspect ratio of the images, the photos that he uses. And there are really three series of film of still images that are very crucial. One is a series of films about Algerian women who have to take off the veil in order to be photographed by police for ID purposes. And the first time that they are actually confronting a camera. And Harun actually covers them again, almost in a kind of protective gesture of, you know, mitigating and undoing this brutal way of exposure. And yet the same gesture is also used in a famous photo which usually very often appears on the cover of books about documentary film or essay films or even about the DVD of Image of the World, which is a photograph taken by one of the Auschwitz guards of people coming off the ramp. In other words, what we might call trophy photos from the famous Auschwitz album. And there again, one of the key scenes in the film is a meditation on what does this look that a woman in the picture gives to the camera, returning that particular look. And again, he frames it, he looks at it differently. There's a way of, we don't have the counter shot, but we do have a way of saying, look, frames is very important. And the scenes that you mentioned of the reconnaissance shots, they're the interesting point. I mean, just to fill in those of you who don't know the film, it's about U.S. in 1944, in May 1944, U.S. reconnaissance planes stationed in Italy fly over Poland and actually take photos of Auschwitz. But they're not looking for Auschwitz because they're actually interested in bombing German factories that produce synthetic rubber that are right next to it. And these images have remained in filing cabinets since 44 or 46 or whenever. And one of the officers that was involved in classifying or just cataloging these images in 1976 saw the TV series Holocaust. And he said, hang on a minute, Auschwitz, that rings a bell. And he went back and actually discovered, so that here you have, as you say, something is in the picture, but it's not seen because it's not looked for. But here you have a massive reframing of those images through what is often thought of as a melodrama and even a soap opera about Auschwitz. In other words, a very controversial and contested representation of the Holocaust actually then leads to rediscovering evidence that the Americans actually saw it, and of course, with the implication they saw it, and not only did they not see it, but they didn't do anything about it, which raises, you know, major questions about how we understand the war aims of the Second World War. The war aims now about the Second World War is about liberating Europe from fascism, and fascism was bad because it killed Jews. Well, as every historian knows, that those were not the war aims of a Roosevelt, and those were not the relationships between Europe and America in the 30s. But, yeah, now comes a but, which is that Farocki's own film had a major reframing, because Images of the World was made over a very long period, about 6 years, and he finally finished it in 1989. But it had its major reception in the United States in 1991. And in an interview, which I had with him on the film in London at the National Film Theatre, he said, it's the oddest thing that's happened to me in my life. There was a film that I thought I was making about the atomic threat, about Pershing missiles being stationed on German soil, about atomic energy and the threat of the atomic bomb. But when the film came back from America, it was a film about surveillance, smart bombs, and the Holocaust. So that here, the intervening reframing was not a melodrama, it was history itself. It was the fall of the wall, it was the first Gulf War, and so Images of the World was, you know, while it was delayed and was actually, in some sense, obsolete in relation to the issues that Harun was primarily concerned with, because after the end of the Cold War, the atomic threat was no longer seen as the primary concern, nor were the Pershing rocket missiles. But we now had General Schwarzkopf and smart bombs. And we had in the meantime, in the 90s, the obsession that we have with our feeling, and even the United States, about our feelings of guilt of not having rescued the Jews. And so the film, being obsolete in one sense, then became incredibly topical. And I would imagine that it had a major effect on Harun's work of redirecting him towards the militarization of our societies, towards surveillance.
Well, what people picked up on in that reception that you're referring to in the early 1990s is his use of the operative image, the surveillance photograph.
Right.
He often used that type of image, scientific pictures, images that weren't really meant to be used aesthetically. He picked up the we'll call it an operative image, mm-hmm. an image with a function that is not, a function that's illustrative, perhaps, mm-hmm. A tool, but not necessarily an aesthetic image. These types of images, of course, are visual, are all images, but they're entirely different from those images that proliferate in our visual culture, such as images that are produced for entertainment or educational purposes or advertising purposes. To what extent do you think that Haroon purposefully cultivated the aesthetics of that operative image that I'm referring to?
Well, this is probably, I mean, you mentioned the term images that were functional or operative images. I think operative images is probably the term that he would have preferred as well. And quite honestly, I think that is probably his most seminal contribution to aesthetics in the 21st century, our understanding of what is an image. And I'll just, if I may, take a little bit of time to explain what I mean by this. In Images of the World, that was what the reason that he took material which came from industrial films, medical films, time and motion studies, a material that by now has a certain interest amongst filmmakers who are making found footage films. But at the time when he was using it, people were saying, well, why should I be looking at this stuff? You know, what is it? And in Images of the World, he relates it back to photogrammatology or photogrammatics, a man called Albrecht Meidenbauer, who used still photographs to measure buildings. And as you will see, there's a beautiful story about how Meidenbauer got the idea that you might be able to use photography as measurement devices. But of course, I only have to name chronophotography and Murray and Muybridge to come to the origins of where the information that a photograph holds is not in the terms of, let's say, a window on the world, a view or an aesthetic representation, but a storage space for data. And of course, images, if you like, images that we're now confronted with, if not all images, digital images, are by their very nature storage devices for data. And the great thing about Haroon is that he realized that very early on that there's something happening in our understanding of what is an image. Way before we had the debate about digital image, he realized that here was something that was fundamental. And it occurred to me when Lev Manovich talked about in one of his essays about archaeology of media, he had a very brutal simplification. He said, human beings have only, in all their history, have only been making two types of images. Images to lie with and images to act with. And images to lie with is all simulation. An image to act with is to do things through images that you can't do because it's too dangerous or it's because it's too far or whatever. And I think there's some truth in that. But what Haroon has brought to this is to say, no, it's no longer that on the one hand we have aesthetic images and on the other hand we have operational images. Simulation is now our primary mode of action. So that difference between simulation and action, which Lev Manovich still made in the 90s, Haroon already knew that was no longer the case. In other words, that operational images are now the default value of all images that we have. And I think that is an insight that will take years to percolate and will actually change our understanding. And I was interested in reading the other day that Jonathan Crary's recent book on 24/7 really asked similar questions. What are we doing with all those images that are not, as you say, for aesthetics, but actually are used and come from other areas? I once said in an article on Farocki, I said, Haroon has taught me that the cinema has many histories, not all of which belong to the movies.
We'll come back to some of this in a Q&A. I want to keep asking a few more questions, and then we can return to some, because your commentary is raising a lot of questions. Now, a number of Haroon's films are related to the military-industrial complex. This is something that he was particularly attentive to for a number of reasons. the somewhat threatening notion of surveillance or of being imaged from above, as we'll see in images of the world that one finds in some of his films, or in images of the world, or in I, Machine, for instance, or even in I Thought I Was Seeing Prisoners, seems to have been prescient. The increase of surveillance culture, especially given the prevalence of drones today, say, or the NSA's massive, almost total surveillance program that we live in, or under. The implication one gets from watching these films is that there's something ominous in being surveilled, whether from above or any other way. Yet I'm perpetually astonished to find that today, while we know that we're being surveilled more than ever before, most people just don't seem to care. Or pushing this even further, rather than mistreated, many people find today that surveillance makes them feel safer. So to what extent do you think that investigating the growing world of surveillance was important for Haroon's work, first of all, to kind of establish that? And to what extent do you think that his films capture these shifts in public attitudes to surveillance over time?
Yes, I think one answer is to say that he was concerned, but he had another way. He was not a pessimist in this sense. And one way of, as it were, both representing what was going on and rescuing to himself a certain equanimity about it was an almost surreal sense of humor. And that you see that, for instance, in the way that he brings together, under the heading of surveillance, high-security prisons and shopping malls. And he says similar principles of how you organize space that people use operates in high-security prisons and in the way that shopping malls are designed for moving people. That's already, I mean, in one sense, it's a joke, and in another sense, it's a deep truth about our societies. But it doesn't come with all that gloominess. On the other hand, he then adds and says, but high security prisons are way ahead of the shopping malls because they no longer rely on surveillance. You know, panopticon is no longer what's at issue, because that's basically, if you like, it was the Foucauldian metaphor of the panopticon that brings together, you know, the kind of surveillance and the self-monitoring that Haroon was very interested in and had wonderful things to say about. But he was saying about high security prisons, they don't have to watch you anymore, they tag you. In other words, that's a completely new technology which is tested in high security prisons, and we still have cameras in shopping malls, but, and this is where the making you feel safe comes in, but as he said, most of those cameras are just there as for show. They don't take any images anymore. So in other words, you know, he was aware that cameras now, if we expect them to keep us safe, are actually no longer functioning because the way we're being tracked is through non-visual means. Mm-hmm, data mining, our telephone conversations, our internet traffic, and so on. But
there's still a lot,
as
of
I said,
cameras,
the joke was that he actually saw the avant-garde in the security prison rather than in modern shopping malls.
One of the...
There's another thought that really, I just, you know, maybe it's useful to put, which again shows how Haroon could be very funny about incredibly serious things. I mean, there is the film Life, you know, Living in the Federal Republic, Leben BRD, How to Live in the Federal Republic. Now, that film, if we now look back, at the time it just seemed an oddball film about people doing fire drills or teaching kids to safely cross the street or learning to be a midwife or learning to be a stripper. And you thought, this is just the kind of kaleidoscope of weird things that he's picked out in Germany, a kind of jaded view of it. But now thinking about it, it actually fits with what we were saying about simulation, because what this film shows is that how social life has become a permanent fire drill, a permanent test drive, a permanent self-monitoring activity and this he would see as part of the militarization of civil society. We're all on training, we're all simulating the emergency. We're all taking a state of exception as a norm, and how our life is entirely devoted to simulating the catastrophe which may already have happened.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So let's just shift a little bit. So rather than a form of direct communication, and rather than a form of direct communication through images that he produced, Haroon often seemed to rely on pre-existing images to mediate, images that he appropriated, images that he found, images that were available, these images that we were talking about earlier, to mediate his communication with the spectator. In other words, he found images in order to communicate with the spectator. Mm-hmm. Now, what do you think the logic of that strategy, that particular strategy was, of mobilizing found images? Was it economic, i.e., if you're finding images and you're not making images, it's less expensive to make films? Was it anti-auteurist? Was it an attempt to produce a form of distanciation in the Brechtian sense, insofar as distanciation is a form of indirectness? What do you think drove that that practice?
Well, it's difficult to know whether it was economic. I can't answer that one. You know, it could be, but it does. I don't think, and the logic of using found footage or using images that had not entered the public sphere in this particular way clearly precedes or is independent and so fundamental to his way of thinking about the world that I don't think economic reasons can explain it or, you know, would help us to understand it.
At all?
Well, maybe, yes, but you know, some images these days, if you get them, are just as expensive as going out for a shoot, you know.
But not then. I'm sorry.
You know, he had friends. I mean, if you look at a film like Zwischen den Kriegen, almost all the parts are friends from film school. You know, it's a small crew. These are not films admittedly, every penny counted, But he was never a filmmaker that had a budget of 10 million or 100, you know, 50 mm-hmm. million at his disposal. So he was somebody who could work with get a lot out of a few dollars, let's put it this way. So I wouldn't make that the main reason. What is, however, very important, and especially now that compilation films and found footage films are so common, and everybody who has Final Cut Pro on their laptop puts together a found footage film. It's important to remember what appropriation might be of material that you find. And I think there, Haroon was incredibly disciplined and incredibly ethical about it. And you know, this may take a little bit too long to kind of show in all its details, but he was somebody. When you think of his very first film, you know, there was also found footage, but there he put his own person into the film in a very, if you like, self-involved way. And I would say that what he showed there, this is a film, you know, Nicht löschbare Feuer, about the Vietnam War and about having solidarity with the Vietnam people, but it was a solidarity which wasn't just, as it were, a solidarity, you know, I'm for, you know, the Viet Cong. This was a solidarity that first had to prove itself on his own body. And I think you can see that kind of self-involvement. I've already said, you know, he made a film about, between the wars, about the trust formation in Germany that supported Hitler, but he himself was also using the trust model, the Verbund model, for his own film. He always asked himself, as a filmmaker, I am as much responsible for the proliferation of images, for the things that images can do, for the agency of images. I cannot just say, I have clean images and others use dirty images.
You see, so that point was, what is the respect that he owes to images? And one of the things that you will find with his found footage is not that he takes things out of it, but that he listens to those images. He's the only, apart from the Straubs, he's the only filmmaker I know who is able to listen to images, what images might say, what they might have wanted to say, and that particular way of having not an eye for an image, but an ear for an image, that's Harun.
So the Straubs were obviously very important to him. So to what extent was the use of these images, this tactic of using the found image, an attempt to produce a form of distanciation? I mean, to come back to the Brechtian dimension of Farocki's work.
Farocki and Brecht, you know, it's an obvious connection, but it depends what you mean by distanciation, you see. What we were talking about earlier, you know, the way that his editing creates these gaps, doesn't actually, that's not a distanciation. He's not didactic in the way that Brecht wanted to be didactic. I would also say, even though Farocki's films are highly reflexive about what it means to make films, it's not the classic modernist reflexivity. It's not about medium specificity. It's about, as I said, it's about taking the responsibility for also making images.
You're combining Brecht with classic modernism? I don't know what you...
Well, that's some ways of... that would be another discussion altogether.
Yeah, that's not together. Yeah.
But I think there's a way in which one can see Brecht thinking he knows better. This is not about the learning place. I think if anywhere... Farocki would have liked the learning plays, but some of the major plays, one gets the sense that Brecht knows better.
Mm-hmm. Now,
And Farocki never gives you that sense that he knows better.
I wanted you to explain something to me, because you've gone on the record in your recent writing to say that Farocki was well aware of how the visible and the intelligible were drifting ever further apart in the late 20th and early 21st centuries. So what do you mean by this? Give us an idea of how this played out in his work, this separation of the perceptible and the intelligible that you're saying is at work.
Well, there you're absolutely right. There in the first films, there was a direct Brechtian reference, or rather there was the reference to a famous Brecht quote. We only have it through Walter Benjamin about a photograph of AEG or the Krupp works doesn't tell us anything about the reality of those institutions. Because, as Brecht says, or as Benjamin has him say, actual reality has become purely functional. It's slipped into the functional. And Zwischen den Kriegen and Etwas wird sichtbar, you know, the first two films very much work on that, that the things that really matter to us capitalism cannot be seized in photographs. So in other words, a critique of capitalism is very difficult to do in the filmic medium, which is a kind of aporia of the political film that was being made or was being attempted in the late 60s and early 70s. What I think you get in the later films is something a little more interesting and a little more paradoxical, perhaps. And that is the insight that more and more, never mind about capitalism, more and more of what determines our lives is no longer visible to the human eye. It's either too fast or too slow, it's either too far away or it's too close. In other words, human vision is no longer the measure of knowledge, and the phrase I see, meaning I know, no longer functions. And now this is an idea that I'm now trying to work through. It occurs to me that when I look at the films that he made about Iraq veterans being, as it were, therapized for their post-traumatic stress disorder through simulation, serious games. You have trauma and simulation as two ways in which you recapture for the body and for the senses that which is not capturable or understandable or visible, but yet nonetheless, you know, has an impact on the body. So I think Farocki may have had a trauma theory that's extremely interesting and that as far as I know, nobody has written about yet. But that has to do with precisely this issue that what impacts us, but it's not visible, is for Harun a very important part of our contemporary world, and it's through this peculiar way of going into an area where we don't expect it, namely the simulation of therapy, that he's trying to understand what these simulated images, you know, what these digital images, what these images in computer games, what are they actually there? They are not representations, they are modes of impacting. And so the hyperrealism is not can't be understood in along the classical representational scheme. It has to be understood in relation to, as I said, maybe trauma, maybe knowing that we are impacted, there are forces operating on us, and we know they exist, but our usual sense organs are not equipped to do that.
Let me ask you one last question, because we're running out of time. We're out of time, actually. All right, you've been following his work for decades, and Farocki's move from cinema spaces to art spaces was related, on the one hand, as you know, to radical changes in European television broadcasting, public television in particular, these changes that came into effect in the late 80s and 80s, early 90s, late 80s, where everything became much more homogenized, and the space, the broadcast space, that used to be available for experimental directors such as Harun, for directors of more experimental films, disappeared.
Yeah.
And on the other hand, it's related to a larger move in the culture that we're all familiar with, where there are many more museums being built than there are experimental cinemas. Harun would say, then there are cinemas, period. But so that the spaces that he used to exhibit his work in were disappearing, and there were these other spaces that were proliferating, i.e. museums, and it was a kind of natural move. As Harun moved, that he moved into the art world, I think, is quite clear, or that there was a shift. But the question I want to ask you is that as he moved into the artwork, as he moved into the art world, his work began to change. I mean, he began to use more film loops, double and multiple screens, mobile montage. So you followed his work for a number of decades. How much do you think his work changed as he moved from cinema spaces to art spaces?
Right. Well, as you pointed out, there were economic reasons. You know that Harun's work in the 80s, or he sustained his work as a filmmaker through either commissions through television or for having his films screened on late night television as the only way of getting any kind of public. And those slots dried up as television, even in Germany, became much more commercially oriented. But as we know, the real breakthrough came with Catherine David's 1997 documenta, where she invited a whole number of filmmakers, Ulrike Ottinger, Hans-Jürgen Sieverberg, Chantal Ackermann, and including Harun Farocki, Jean-Luc Godard, and so on, to present their work as filmmakers in art spaces. And I think that, in some cases, interestingly enough, that was quite a shock for filmmakers to be in a different space. And filmmakers responded differently. Some filmmakers made longer and longer films. And there's a logic
for sure.
to that. There's a logic to that, which is the logic of creating anxiety of missing, because it's quite clear you couldn't see a Chantal Ackermann de Lest six-hour film or Ulrike Ottinger film in a museum. So there was this temptation either to keep your autonomy or your resistance by making films that are too long for the museum, or on the other hand, to adopt and adapt to the museum by making looped films. I think in Harun's case, you could say, yes, it was a change, and he's gone on record that it allowed him to rethink what he was doing, but there's also a way of thinking that he's always, we've talked about his editing, the end, as opposed to the juxtaposition or the dialectical clash. The "and" is already the two-screen presentation. In other words, Harun's films, when we now go back, can be seen already always having thought about what it means to have, as it were, montage, not on one screen, but in space. And his films are, even though sometimes they're linear, you don't necessarily see them as linear. And some films are actually, if you look closely, they're already loops. They may be an hour and a half, but they're still, you know, function as a loop. So I would say that Harun found it in some sense quite natural to take his particular form of editing, and in one of the films where he explains this in very lucid ways is Schnittsteller, Interface, where, you know, he shows you how these two spaces, he calls them Schreibtisch and Schneidertisch. In German this sounds better because they're almost the same words, you know, writing desk and editing table. Schreibtisch, Schneidertisch, and writing and editing images and words, and how one can stay for the other. And his films, I think, always had what you might call a peripatetic dimension. You know, the film wasn't driven by some narrative deadline or by some narrative telos. They were meandering films that went one way, that came a fork in the road, that took up an argument that we had 20 minutes earlier and brought it back. In other words, in a Farocki film, even though you were, in those days, locked into an irreversible flow, you were encouraged to take your time and walk around in the film. So in that sense, once you're in the museum and you take your time and you walk around, that was germane to him. And now comes the interesting reversal.
Is that the essayistic dimension?
Well, yes, but that, you know, let's not start on the essay film. And we have Nora sitting there, who should really then take my place if we have any essay. But the interesting thing that I then found, when Harun made a single channel work, namely The Silver and the Cross, about one gigantic painting.
That's a double channel.
It's a double. Yeah. It's a two-channel. I saw it as a one-channel.
Yeah, he did send a sample single-channel,
right?
Study purposes.
Let me just make that. Maybe I'm totally wrong, but maybe it actually still makes sense. But you see, what you get is that, you know, it sets up an opposition then and now, you know, because it's about a silver mine
Potosí mine.
Well, it's actually a mountain. It's a silver mountain, rather.
Hill.
And a hill, right. And what you get is that the camera, so you have the opposition and a static shot. In other words, the filmmaker takes exactly the same position as the painter took. And so you have this parallel there, which is probably the double one. But what really interested me is how the camera, as it were, prowls through the painting, and the painting is full of horses and people walking up the hill, walking down the hill, walking through the side streets, and the camera imitates that particular way of meandering, walking, prowling, climbing, and so that in actual fact, never mind whether it's a single or a double, but even as if it was a single one, you would still have the experience, because it was actually shown in this exhibition, the Potosí Principle, in other words, which was not a film showing, but it was a mega exhibition in Berlin, in Madrid, and La Paz. Nonetheless, you are actually in this film, or in this exploration of the painting, you are now in the mold of the installation. In other words, he was able to turn this huge painting into an installation.
That's interesting.